Alright, so this is a calculus problem in which they want us to find the limit as x approaches infinity for a given function, as well as x approaching negative infinity for that same given function. And the function that we have is this rational function here. What they really want us to find with these two limits as x approaches infinity and negative infinity are the horizontal asymptotes. Alright, so as we go off to a negative or positive infinity, we're looking for horizontal asymptotes. They want us to find all the asymptotes as well, so we'll find the vertical ones also. Let's see, let's find the horizontal asymptotes first. Right? Let's find the horizontal ones first. To find the horizontal asymptotes, one way to look at this, maybe probably the easiest way to look at this, is to notice that the degree of the numerator is a 4, and the degree of the denominator is a 4. So since the degree for the numerator is a 4, let's see, the book I'm using says since m is equal to n, since the two degrees are the same, numerator and denominator, then what we need to do is look at the leading coefficients for both the numerator and the denominator, and simply our y equals, this is going to be our horizontal asymptote, to whatever that ratio happens to be. Well, obviously the ratio, or the number, for a leading coefficient up top is a 2. And for the denominator, since I don't see one, it's an automatic 1. So, okay, so y equals 2 is the limit as x approaches infinity. Turns out it's the same as x approaches negative infinity. So that's one easy way to find the horizontal asymptotes, or asymptotes. In this case, though, you know, the book shows there is another method that we could use if you wanted to. Let me show you that as well, okay? When you're dealing with rational functions like these, what you can do is you can concentrate on the denominator and look at the denominator's largest exponent. In this case, it's going to be a 4, right? So I'm writing out my problem again here, rewriting this thing. I'm going to rewrite it just like this. So noticing that the denominator's largest exponent is a 4, what we can do with that x to the fourth is we can divide every single term in the numerator and the denominator by x to the fourth. So I'm going to write it like this. Divide everybody here by x to the fourth, even these guys on the bottom. So, you know, let's say that the numerator's largest exponent was a 5. Doesn't matter. You're concentrating on the denominators, right? All of these terms in the bottom, the denominator's largest exponent. That's the one you're looking for. And then you're going to divide everybody by that same largest exponent, in this case, x to the fourth. What does that do for us? Well, here's what it does for us, okay? Here's what it does for us. It says, all right, hey, look, these x to the fourths cancel out. And so I'm simply left with a 2 right there, coming from there, okay? Let's see, x to the third cancels out with x to the fourth. Well, it cancels out 3 of these x's down here, so I'm left with 2 over x, right? Because 3 of these cancel out with 3 of these, leaving me with 1 more. Hey, look, 2 of these x's cancel out with 2 of these x's on the bottom. That leaves me with x squared on the bottom. This is minus 60 over x squared. And I'm going to do the same thing for these 3 terms in the denominator. So let's see, this is just going to be a 1. Minus, let's see, this is a 61 over x squared, right? And out of this, nothing cancels out. I'm just going to leave that as 900 over x to the fourth. Now, the reason I'm doing that is because you should recognize from calculus that as the limit approaches infinity or negative infinity, all right, these terms right here, like this one, this one, this one, and this one are all going to go to 0. Alright, so as we head off to both positive infinity and negative infinity, as we head off to negative infinity as well, alright, these terms right here, with anything with an x, or an x squared, or an x to the third, or an x to the fourth, anything with an x in its denominator, these guys are all going to go to 0. So do you see that we're left with just a 2 over 1? And that's simply the case no matter in which direction we're heading, right? Positive or negative. And so I'm just going to say, hey, the limit is 2. No problem there. All right, let's go a little bit further. Now we have the horizontal asymptotes. Let me write that up here. So we have the horizontal asymptotes. in this case there's really only one asymptote, is y equals 2. That's it. Okay, what about the vertical asymptotes? Right, for this exact same problem. Well, let's see. To find the vertical asymptotes, let me go back to my original problem here. I need to find out what value or values for x is going to make this denominator a zero. All right. Now it's not easy to see that right now, but if I factor everything as much as I can up top and factor these terms here on the bottom as much as I can, I hope you see this is what I'll end up with. All right. I'll end up with, let's see, these guys in the numerator all have a 2x squared in common that I can take out. I guess I'll show you the intermediate steps here. I'm left with an x squared plus x minus 30. And these three terms on the bottom turn into x squared minus 36 and x squared, minus 25. Okay, but it turns out that this trinomial in the numerator and these two guys on the denominator can still be factored further. Okay, so I'm going to factor these guys a little bit more. I'm going to leave that 2x squared alone in the numerator, but this trinomial here up top I can factor a little bit more into x plus 6 and x minus 5. And since both of these in the denominator are difference of squares, I can do this. Right, we can split up this x squared minus 36 as x plus 6 and x minus 6, and this x squared minus 25 as x plus 5 and x minus 5. And now that I've factored as much as possible, can you see that there are four values that would make my denominator 0? Okay, there'd be a negative 6 coming out of this one, positive 6 coming out of this one, negative 5 for that one, and positive 5 for that one. All four of those values would make my denominator a 0. So the function is undefined at four of those points. But not all four of them are vertical asymptotes. Why not? Well, do you see that this binomial and that one, right, since they're the same on top and on the bottom, they cancel out, as well as these. So it turns out there are really only two vertical asymptotes, x equals 6 and x equals negative 5. Okay, so there are really only two vertical asymptotes. Now, the last thing, right, if you're my math lab or your homework wants one more thing out of this problem, and that is, okay, so you have the two vertical asymptotes, fine, but what is the function doing as far as we approach these two values coming from either side? So maybe the question is asking something like this. All right, let me write our simplified form here. Got x minus 6 and x plus 5. So this is the simplified form of our original rational function. And so we know, here's 0 right there, so we know that there is a vertical asymptote here at 6, and we know that there's a vertical asymptote here at negative 5. Let's find out the behavior of the function. What is the function going to do as we approach these asymptotes coming from either side? Right, coming from either side. Let's start off with this one. If we approach negative 5 on the left side of negative 5, as we come at it from the left side, the way I'm pointing here with my finger, all of these numbers over here are negative, right? Negative 6, negative 7, negative 8, etc. So all of these numbers here are negative. That makes these two parentheses here, a negative minus 6 stays a negative, and a negative plus 5 stays a negative. That means I've got two negatives in the denominator, which is really just a positive since they're being multiplied, and a negative value squared stays positive. So it turns out that everything over here coming from the right-hand side of the function, right, coming in this direction here, everything is going to be positive. Right? Let's try out coming at negative 5 from the right-hand side of it, though. Coming from the left, it's going to be positive. Let's see what happens coming from the right. Well, let's see. How about values of negative 4, negative 3, or negative 2, or negative 1? You know, you can pick any one you want. How about negative 4, for instance? If I plugged in a negative 4, negative 4 minus 6 is a negative number. Negative 4 plus 5, though, actually is a positive number. So I'd have a negative times a positive, which is a negative. So my denominator is negative, my numerator is positive because it's being squared anyways, right? So I've got a negative on the bottom and a positive on top. Actually, it turns out all of these values down here in between negative 5 and 6 are negative numbers. Right, so coming at negative 5 from the right-hand side is a negative infinity. Coming at negative 5 from the from the left-hand side is a positive infinity. Likewise, coming at 6 from the left-hand side is a negative infinity. But coming at 6 from the right-hand side, let's see, these numbers would be 7 or 8 or negative, these are all positives, right? Positive 8, positive 9. You can plug in any number you want over here. Let's say 8, right? If we plugged in 8, 8 minus 6 is positive, and 8 plus 5 is positive, and my numerator is automatically positive, so the whole thing is positive. So we're talking about a positive infinity, right? A positive infinity that's going on this side, coming at 6 from the right-hand side. So you could say, right, that we have vertical asymptotes. As far as the vertical asymptotes are concerned, you could say that, look, the limit, as we approach negative 5 coming from the left-hand side is going to be, right, for this particular function, is going to be a positive infinity. That's this thing here, right? And likewise, the limit as we approach, if you can see that or not, the limit as we approach negative 5 coming from the right-hand side of this function is a negative infinity, right? If we approach negative 5 coming from the right-hand side is a negative infinity. And I could say that the limit as we approach 6 coming from the left-hand side, 6 coming from the left-hand side here, is this negative infinity for our function. And the limit as we approach 6 coming from the right-hand side of our function, right, here we go, coming at 6 from the right-hand side is a positive infinity, as we have up there. So, there you go. Hope that helps.